Welcome to Homeopathic Pharmacy Academy. In this video lecture, I am going to discuss about the common laboratory methods and procedures used in a homeopathic laboratory. In these common laboratory methods and procedures are usually done in connection with the standardization of homeopathic drugs as well as preparation of homeopathic drugs. Let us see what are the laboratory methods used in homeopathic pharmacy. The common laboratory methods and procedures which we usually practiced in homeopathic pharmacy are solution, dilution, sedimentation, decantation, filtration, sublimation, evaporation, distillation, and crystallization. So let us see one by one. The first one is solution. So in all the procedures in the lab, we must prepare some or other type of solutions. So let us see what are solutions. A solution is a chemically and physically homogeneous mixture of two or more substances. Here the solute means the dissolved substances and the solvent means the medium in which the solutes are uniformly dispersed. So the substance which is dissolved in a solution is called solute, and the substance where a substance is made to dissolve is called as a solvent. Now let us see the types of solutions. Depending upon the nature of solutions, the solutions are classified into saturated solution, unsaturated solution, and super saturated solutions. Saturated solutions are if the solvent refuses to dissolve any further quantity of solute, then it is known as saturated solution. So how the saturated solutions are made? When a solute is easily soluble in a solvent, it will dissolve in the solvent, and at a particular stage there is no more space for a solute to dissolve in the solvent, and then that particular solution is known as saturated solutions. Now this can be experimentally we can prove it. When you dissolve sugar in water at a particular concentration, the sugar may not dissolve in the water. It becomes saturated. And that particular state is called a saturated solution. Next one is unsaturated solutions. So it contains less amount of solute for preparing a saturated solution. So it is just before the stage of saturated solutions, where a solute is there is more space for a solute to dissolve in a solvent. So such type of solutions are called unsaturated solutions. Now another type of solution is supersaturated. Supersaturated solution contains more amount of solute than is necessary to make a saturated. So always supersaturated solutions may not dissolve the required concentration of solute, and this solute will be appearing as a undissolved matter in the solution. So such solutions are known as supersaturated solutions. Now let us discuss about some descriptive terms which is used in solutions or solubility. So always when you describe any substances or chemicals, we describe in terms of solubility of that substance. So what is solubility? Solubility is a amount of a solute dissolved in a given solvent. And based on the relative quantity of solvent for a one part of solute, we can describe the solubility in terms of certain terminologies. So first one is very soluble. Very soluble means there is less than one part of solvent for a one part of solute. So that means it is very soluble. So equal part of solute and equal part of solvent, if it is taken, it will be dissolved. So that is very soluble. And freely soluble means for a one part of solute, the relative quantity of solvent is ranges from 1 part to 10 parts. So 1 to 10 parts is required to of solvent is required to dissolve one part of solute. That is called as freely soluble. Now soluble means for one part of solute, it requires 10 to 30 parts of solvent. Then it is known as soluble. Next is sparingly soluble. Sparingly soluble requires 30 to 100 parts of solvent to dissolve one part of solute. Now, slightly soluble means it requires 100 to 1000 parts of solvent to dissolve one part of solute. Now, very slightly soluble means it requires 1000 to 10,000 parts of solvent to dissolve one part of solvent. So that is very slightly soluble. Now practically insoluble means it requires more than 10,000 parts of solvent to dissolve one part of solvent. So these are the terms which is used to describe the solubility of a substance, of a solute. Now let us see the percentage solutions. So what are the percentage solution? We in the standardization we always come across these type of percentage solutions. Now weight by weight percentage solution. Weight by weight percentage solution means the solute is expressed, the quantity of solute is expressed in terms of weight, as well as the quantity of solvent is described or represented in terms of weight. That means 1 gram in 10 grams, 1/10%, 1/10%, or one part or 1 gram in 100 grams of solvent. So that is a 0.001%, 1/100% solution. So this is how it is represented. Now another type of percentage solutions are weight by volume percentage of solution. So these percentage, sometimes the solute may be in solid state, whereas the solvent may be in liquid state. So solute is represented, the quantity of solute is represented in weight, whereas the quantity of solvent is represented by volume. For example, suppose if you dissolve lactose in alcohol or lactose in water, we can represent it like 1 gram of lactose dissolved in 100 ml of water. So that is represented by weight, 1 gram of lactose, that is weight, dissolved in 100 milliliter of water. So the water is represented in volume, whereas the quantity of lactose is represented as weight. So that is weight by volume percentage. Now another one is if both solute and solvent if it is in liquid state, we usually represent it by volume by volume percentage solution. For example, alcohol and water. If alcohol mixed in water, if you say it is a 10% alcoholic solution, that means the one part of alcohol or 1 ml of alcohol in 10 ml of water. So both are represented in volumes. So that is called as volume by volume percentage. Now next one is volume by weight percentage of solution. So here the solute is represented in volume, whereas solvent is represented by weight. So such type of solutions are called as volume by weight percentage solutions. So this is about the solutions, various type of solutions and various type of percentage solutions, and the descriptive terms which is used to describe the solubility of a substance. Now let us see the next method, that is the dilution. So dilution means the act of diluting, and here when you dilute something, the physicochemical property is reduced and the quantity is increased. So when you dilute any substance, whether it is a solid or liquid, the physical properties and the chemical property is reduced and the quantity is increased. So that type of method is called as dilution, and this has to be explained in terms of homeopathic terminology. Here dilution doesn't mean that it is potency or attenuations. Now homeopathic dilution means it is the attenuated dilutions. So that means even though the physicochemical property is reduced, by the process of potentization, its dynamic energy is increased. The dynamic action is increased. But in a mere dilution, its dynamic property is not increased. It's only a physicochemical property is reduced. But in homeopathic attenuation or potentization, the physicochemical property is reduced by the dynamic action is increased. So that is the difference between homeopathic potentization or attenuation and dilution, mere dilution. Now let us see the next method, that is sedimentation. Sedimentation is a method of settling down the insoluble solid from a liquid. So this sedimentation process we have seen while preparing mother tinctures. So it has to be, the insoluble substance will be sedimented at the bottom of a solvent, and the soluble substances will remain in the topmost. So it is the method of settling down the insoluble substance from a liquid. And the next process is decantation. So always this sedimentation and decantation are a consecutive methods or processes. So once the sedimentation happens, the next process is decantation. It is a process of slowly and carefully pouring out liquid from one vessel to another vessel without disturbing the sediments. So this both the sedimentation and decantations are useful in the process of extracting a mother tincture. So once a mother tincture is prepared, either in old method or new method, the insoluble substance will be settled down as an insoluble solid. And this the soluble mother tincture is decanted out by slowly tilting the vessel and carefully pouring out the liquid or mother tincture from one vessel to another without disturbing the insoluble sediment, and that process is known as decantation. And by the way, these are the pictures of old and modern analytical laboratories. The next method is filtration. The filtration is a process we usually employed in preparation as well as in the standardization of drug substances. So it is an efficient physical process of separation of a liquid from substances insoluble in that liquid with the help of a filtering medium. So it is a type of physical process of separation. Physical process of separation of a liquid substance from an insoluble substance in that liquid with the help of some filtering medium. The various type of filtering media we are using for efficient filtration. So let us see what are the filtering media we used for efficient filtration. The very commonly used filtration media is, or filter media is, filter paper or a filter cloth, a cotton wool, a glass wool, asbestos, membrane filters, then sintered glass filters. So let us see some pictures of types of filters. You can see the glass filters, the left side, and the filter paper, the right side. And this type of the quality of the filtrate depends on the filter media. So if you use a filter paper, the quality is low, whereas if you use a sintered glass filter, which we can see in this picture, the quality of filtrate is more. Now let us see what are the factors affecting the filtration. The porosity of the filter media. So we have seen the different types of filter media. So this filter media depends on the porosity of the filter. This classification is made based on the porosity. So if the porosity is more, then the quality of filtration will be less. Whereas if the porosity is less, then the quality of the filtration will be more. Next is the viscosity of the liquid. If the liquid is more viscous, then the rate of filtration is less. Whereas if it is having less viscosity, the rate of filtration will be more. So the relation between the proportion of solid particle and the rate of filtration, if more number of solid particles are present, then the rate of filtration will be less, as you know. And if less number of solid particles are present, then the rate of filtration will be more. Decreasing pressure. So if you decrease the pressure in the collecting vessel, then the rate of filtration will be more. And if you increase the pressure of the vessel where the solvent is kept, then the rate of filtration will be more. So these two types. So where the decreased pressure is applied, the decreased pressure should be applied in the collecting vessel, so the rate of filtration will be more. So if you increase the pressure where the solvent is kept, then also the rate of filtration is more. Now about the surface area. So if the surface area is less, then the rate of filtration will be more, and if the surface area is more, then the rate of filtration will be less. Now let us see the types of filtration. Hot filtration. So hot filtration is usually employed some solid substances or some semi-solid substances which are heat liable. So when you heat such substances, it becomes liquid, and we can easily filter or purify such substances. For example, wax. Wax, you know, it is a heat liable a substance which can be easily affected with a heat, and by heating the wax become liquid, and we can carry out the filtration while in its hot stage and purify the balance. Now, rapid filtration by reducing pressure in receiving body. So when there is a reduced pressure in a receiving body, the filtration rate will be more, as I said before. So that is a method of rapid filtration by reducing pressure in receiving bottle. This can be achieved by keeping a vacuum pump which is attached with the receiving bottle. Now, straining is a process which we usually employed for a filtration of mother tinges, and straining is otherwise known as force filtration for viscous fluid and suspensions. So this is usually done with the muslin cloth or a cotton cloth, and the nature of solvent which we usually employ for straining is more of a viscous liquid or suspensions. So these are some examples of hot filtrations here. It is heated. The substance is heated and it is wet filtered. Now, rapid filtration, you know, this is attached with a vacuum pump, Venturi pump, and it is attached with the receiving body. Now, next method is evaporation. So, evaporation, all of you know, it's a process of removing a liquid from a solution. So, evaporation can be done by, the usual method is by boiling. So, evaporation is done to concentrate the liquid. Usually to concentrate the liquid. So the usual method is by boiling, but if a substance, a solvent containing heat liable substance, it should not be boiled by direct heating. It can be boiled by indirect heating, or the other method is evaporation below the boiling point. It should not allow to boil, but the temperature is set below the boiling point, the slowly the evaporation will carried out without disturbing or destroying the heat liable substance in that particular solvent. And another method is called as spontaneous evaporation. So this spontaneous evaporation is usually seen in the volatile substances. Without heat also, it will be evaporated. For example, alcohol or any type of volatile liquids will be subjected to spontaneous evaporation at the atmospheric temperature. Another method is which we usually employed in laboratories, distillation. So distillation can be simple distillation. So distillation is a process of converting a liquid into gas and condensing the gas back to the liquid. So that is called a distillation. So it is it's a process. There are two processes involved in distillation. One is the evaporation and also the condensation. So liquid, when the heat is applied, converted into vapor, then vapor again is cooled, it comes to liquid. So that is a simple distillation. Another type of distillation is fractional distillation. So here in fractional distillation, what happens is, especially petroleum, example is petroleum. The crude petroleum is subjected to fractional distillation, and the ingredients in the crude petroleum will be separated out depending on the boiling temperature. So depending on the temperature, it will be separated. At 20 degree petroleum gas is separated out, at 150 degree Celsius gasoline or petrol is separated out, 200 degree kerosene is separated out, 300 degree diesel is separated out, then 370 degree fusel oil is separated out. So and the last one is a lubricating oil or paraffin wax. So this is how the fractional distillation of crude oil is carried out. So depending on the temperature which is amenable for distillation, each substances are separated out. So such type of distillation is known as fractional distillation. Then another type of distillation is vacuum distillation. So vacuum distillation, it is connected with a vacuum generating machine, and the vacuum, if you create a vacuum, then distillation process will be it facilitate or increase the rate of distillation. So that is how it is constructed. The next method is sublimation. Sublimation is nothing but it is a process of converting solid substance directly into vapor on heating without being converted into liquid. So this we know what is sublimation. Now in homeopathic pharmacy, we employ this method of sublimation in the purification of iodine. And if the iodine is mixed with some impurities, we heat the iodine, and there is a production of iodine vapor, and these iodine vapors are again condensed, and it forms the crystals of iodine. You can see the topmost for crystals of iodine, and these iodine crystals are very purified. So that is how the sublimation process is carried out. And there are some other substances like camphor. Camphor also purified by the method of sublimation. We are heating the flakes of camphor, it converted into vapor, and this vapor, camphor vapors, is subjected to condensation. It becomes the crystals of camphor again. So this is how camphor is purified. Next method is crystallization. Crystallization is a process of formation of crystals when the solution of a solid substance in a liquid is saturated at a higher temperature and is allowed to cool down. Once the solution is saturated at a higher temperature, and if it is allowed to cool, it becomes crystals. Now there is another term that is called as the water of crystallization. So here, water of crystallization means, so in between the intermolecular space of crystals, there may be some molecules of water lodged. So water is lodged in between the intermolecular space of these crystals, and that water is called as crystallization. And what is the relevance of this water of crystallization? This water of crystallization may change the physical property of the crystal. For example, here you can see the copper sulfate crystals. Copper sulfate crystals, if it is associated with the water, or copper sulfate crystals in between the copper sulfate molecules, if some molecules of water is present, then the color of the crystal is blue in color. Once you heat the crystal, the water is evaporated, and the next picture we can see the colorless crystals of copper sulfate. Okay. So once the water is evaporated, it becomes colorless. So this is how a water of crystallization changes the physical properties of the crystals. Now let us see the another method in the laboratory, that is a determination of moisture content. So determination of moisture content is a very important laboratory procedure which we conducted before the preparation of drug, especially in new method. So we know in new method of Mother Tincture preparation, the moisture should be estimated to calculate the monograph formula of for the preparation of Mother Tinctures. So this moisture content estimation is done by several methods. The very usual method and is which is recommended by Homeopathic Pharmacopoeia of India is gravimetric method or loss on drying. Another method is a distillation method, that is separation and measurement of moisture by distillation method. Then a chemical method by using Carl Fischer titration. Then automatic moisture analyzer, that is an automatic method. So these are the important methods which we used to estimate moisture. Let us see the first one, that is gravimetric method. So the procedure of gravimetric method is, place about 10 gram of drug after accurately weighing in a tarred evaporating dish. Tarred evaporating dish means the previously heated evaporating dish. Then dry at 105 degrees Celsius for 5 hours in hot air oven and not the weight. Continue the drying and weighing at 1 hour interval until the difference between two successive weighing corresponds to not more than 0.25%. So there should be a negligible difference between the two successive weighing. So that should be not more than 0.25%. And once it is reached, that is a constant weight. So the previous one and the last one's weight is almost negligible. Then we call it as constant weight. It is less than 0.25%, then it is known as constant weight. So once a constant weight is reached, two consecutive weighings after drying for 30 minutes and cooling for 30 minutes in a evaporating jar, the weight is again taken. Now we should find out the difference between the initial weight and the final weight, and find out the percentage, how much moisture is evaporated. So that will be the moisture content of that particular drug substance or plant. So this is how the gravimetric method is carried out. Now the next method is chemical method or Karl Fischer titration. So here Karl Fischer reagent is used for this purpose. So it is a sensitive reagent which can predict the presence of moisture or water in a solution. It is titrated against a sample containing water, which causes a loss of dark brown. So if it contains water, the dark brown color of the reagent will disappear. And at the end time, when there is no water is available, the color of the reagent persists. So with this color, we can identify whether it is free from water or not, or whether it contains moisture or not. And it is also known as colorimetric titration, because the color is used to estimate the moisture which is present in the solvent. Now the distillation method. Here in distillation method, the sample to be analyzed is placed in a flask together with a suitable water saturated immiscible solvent, and it is distillated. And now the water in the sample co-distillate with the solvent and condense in the distillate as a immiscible layer. So the water along with a saturated immiscible solvent is distillated out. So the water and this immiscible solvent will evaporate, and when it is condensed, the water along with this solvent will distillate out, but as an immiscible layer. So we are taking a water saturated immiscible solvent, so it will not dissolve, this solvent will not dissolve in water. So in the distillate, it will seen as a separate layer. So this is how we can measure the quantity of water, because it is seen as a separate layer. So we can find out the quantity of water which is present in a particular substance. Now another method, so the distillation method, in a sample to be analyzed is placed in a flask together with a water saturated immiscible solvent, it is distillated, and specially devised apparatus permits the direct measurement of water obtained and the less than solvent is continuously returned to the distillation. So this is how the distillation method is carried out. And with this, I am concluding the lecture on the various laboratory methods which we usually employed in the homeopathic laboratory.